Yep, once more with the Wadjet Eye, but what can I say? It's been 3 years since I played one of their games for the first time, and they've yet to steer me wrong. Granted, they're just publishing this one, but their track record with games they didn't make themselves is still really good. Speaking of, this is from Technocrat Games, a small indie developer who decided to make Technobabylon. Wait, a cyberpunk themed point and click game in association with Wadjet Eye? It might have been a month off with the release date, but it still felt like my birthday. Don't worry though, I take my reviewer responsibilities seriously, and I will say something bad about it, probably. Let us start. We open with a man talking with a lady person about a different lady person, but unless anyone else can see that floating blue rectangle, he must look like an absolute lunatic to those people walking past. After a spontaneous headache, more talking, a brief monologue, and a title card, we switch to a lady who is supposedly floating inside the internet. And yeah, I don't see any cats or bacon, so I'm calling bull here. Her existential bliss is interrupted by disconnection, sending her back to the grimy ass real world and the floating lady's real identity, Latha. So she's off to see the maintenance man, the wonderful-
Ah! Ouch.
And that's how the game starts. Stuck indoors and wanting to do the other thing. For lack of a better term, Latha hacks her way through the door and out of her apartment, which explodes. We then cut to 20 hours earlier and some officers of the law investigating a disturbance in an office building. But they can't get in the elevator. Ah well, time to go. Oh my god, he's broken in half! The untold cruelty! The senseless waste! Ooh, a keycard. You can consider the game properly started now, I guess, despite the fact you've met four characters and you've already played as half of them. Technobabylon doesn't really tell you much up front, aside from we be cyberpunk up in here. Which was enough for me, frankly, but then again, I have a problem. I mean, I thought Gemini Rue was cyberpunk, but comparing it back now, I can only say Gemini Rue is set in the future. Technobabylon is cyberpunk as all hell. Apart from, say, not being able to access email outside of a terminal, for a cyberpunk game released in 2015, that's weird. And I wouldn't pick on it so much if there weren't a puzzle hint in there, but the setting, the technological concept, the look of the city you're in, they all scream cyberpunk. Even the music has shades of Deus Ex about it at times, which is about as far from being a bad thing as you can get without including cats and biscuits. Great stuff. And from all the grim dark future neon that one might expect from this genre, it's not afraid to be funny when it gets the chance. These are humans we're dealing with. Mostly. You'll spend the game alternating between Latha, the unemployed trans addict who got her apartment all exploded, and the duo of Regis and Lau, CES officers on the trail of a serial killer called the Mindjacker, with all three unravelling the inevitable conspiracies as they go. Now, there's a lot of jargon in that last sentence, I know, and the game kind of throws you into it with the hope that you'll persevere. There's some explanations to be found for the more obscure stuff, but at the very least you need to right-click something to get it. That's pretty much the whole interface too, by the way. Right-click to look and left-click to do. If there was a button that brought up your inventory, I might consider it pretty perfect, but alas, you have to shove your mouse in the bottom right corner to see your loot. Aside from the handy number key shortcuts for dialogue choices, there's not much to blab about here, so back to the jargon. There's a few concepts I feel could have been better explained. For example, there's the trance. I think of it as a combination of the web and VR. Simplified, but it works. People converse, create, and sometimes live in this virtual world thanks to cybernetic implants. This is why I'm not allowed to get an internet connection in my head, by the way. I would be a pile of bones within a week. Latha and Lau both have such implants and are very adept at using them to hack all sorts of systems. Computer terminals, door locks, food machines, cleaning robots, quite the variety. How this hackery starts is by using a glob of wetware on the system, and then the neuron bluey goop. I haven't a clue. Use a glob of goop on a computer type object, gain access to it with your head. That's the long and short of it. It's easier if you just look at it as an item puzzle, and you do it often enough that it just becomes second nature anyway. Then the concept comes to its illogical conclusion when you visit a trans den and find the access terminal completely coated in goop. Ew. I don't really know how much of an issue this is, to tell you the truth, because I personally didn't really have a problem with it. I didn't even look up a walkthrough because of my inexplicable deep-seated feeling that I'd be slandering the game somehow, you know, not giving it its due. That wasn't always easy, but some perseverance got me through. It was sheer bloody-mindedness that got me this achievement, though. Technobabylon is very fond of puzzles that instantly complicate themselves, partly due to some of the persistent items you'll use, like the stun gun or your wetware, but in structure as well. You want to accomplish one task, but you need to accomplish another one to do it first, and then another one pops up, and so on. I did find it offload logically, even if the constant compounding of complexities and complications sometimes got a bit fatiguing and left me with the song Hole in a Bucket stuck in my head for some reason. But you have the freedom to explore, since there's no way to make the game unwinnable. You can get killed, but much like Resonance before it, you'll be kicked back to before you made the fatal error. No fancy rewind effect this time though, that's a pity. That's not even mentioning the fact that there are two endings to see, some puzzles have multiple solutions, or the fact that certain puzzles are randomised so they're different on each playthrough. Basically, they didn't half-arse this. By the way, if you do play through more than once, you'll want to do it with the commentary track on. It's only one per person per scene this time round, rather than having floating doodads everywhere, and the entire blooper reel is up on YouTube instead of in-game. As for the commentary which is there, James Dearden of Technocrat Games does a very funny and so very British job here, absolutely worth a listen. He's the new one of the bunch, joining the usual staples of producer Dave Gilbert, composer Nathan Allen Bernard, and artist Ben Chandler on board the commentary train. But this is all usual stuff for a Wadjet Eye release. It'd be like saying that the graphics are in a somewhat pixelated 2D game from the 90s art style, which definitely needs a catchier name, or saying you will click on a thing at some point. Although it's worth noting that if you're particularly sensitive to gore, it really doesn't hold back in that department. It's not constant, but it is there. Anyway, enough about all the extra stuff that not everybody cares about and shouldn't really affect games critique. I really like this game. I like how it plays, I like what it tries to say, and the ideas it tries to explore, either through non-immersive means like dialogue, or immersive means like the computer terminals you can play about with. Technobabylon seems really unafraid to tell you what this world is like and what's considered normal within it. An AI controlling all the functions of a major city? Check. Robots? Duh. Full immersion internet? Yeah. Jetpacks? Hell yeah. Future blimps? Okay. And that's before we get onto the cast of characters. Androids, of course. Gay characters? Yep. A trans character? Sure. Characters whose violent instincts and ability to lie are restricted by a government-mandated cybernetic implant? Well, that seems overly specific, but yeah, there's a couple. The prevailing attitude here seems to have been, why the hell not? Your own attitude as to how well that works will depend highly on whether or not you feel these often excluded types of characters should have these traits put up front and centre or not. This game chooses not. When these characteristics are brought up, they're never an issue, they never specifically inform the story, nor derail it. It's just an accepted part of this world. It's normal. And I'm fine with that. It's also impressive that damn near everyone you talk to is a character, rather than a mere dialogue dispenser or a painful stereotype. Wow. It's actually fun to talk to them and see what makes them tick. So now I've finished tripping over in my soapbox, I can get to the obvious part where I tell you if this is worth getting. Do you like cyberpunk stories and or point-and-click adventures? If so, buy it! Anyone else with a more vague level of interest, there's a free demo to try. Consider this a pretty strong recommendation. Man, this is dangerously close to the company doing everything about a release right. I mean, I could tell you which parts weren't done as well as they could have been, but they're all nitpicks, nothing that would actually ruin your enjoyment. I can't guarantee this will be your bag or change your life or cure your athlete's foot or anything, but give the free goddamn demo a try. You've got a great example here of what the genre's doing these days. Wait, I was meant to say something bad about it, wasn't I? You can only use keypads with the mouse instead of typing numbers, and yeah, that's all I've got.